All right, let's start by talking about normalizing inputs to improve gradient descent. So essentially, input normalization. Yeah, so this is just a brief recap why we normalize inputs for gradient descent. We already talked about this a little bit when we talked about gradient descent and stochastic gradient descent. I think that was in lecture 5. So yeah, just to recap, why do we normalize those weights? So that's really to find a good learning rate and to have a, I would say, more stable training. So suppose for simplicity, we have here shown a surface plot of a convex loss function. So here, this is like a convex function shown here. So usually when we work with deep neural networks, that's not the case. That's not a convex function anymore, but just for simplicity, assume here it's convex. And we have a, let's say, linear model, let's say linear regression with two weights, just to keep things simple, ignoring the bias also. Now, technically, when we have something like gradient descent, and this is fully circular, let's say in this lower case here, we would usually take steps perpendicular to these contours. However, when we have stochastic gradient descent, also these steps won't be perpendicular anymore, and especially this will be exaggerated if we have these elliptical losses, so where we may overshoot in one dimension. So instead of, let's say, going here, we take a step perpendicular, but instead of stopping here and then taking this step here, we overshoot and then we go this zigzagging. And then also, if we have stochastic gradient descent, this is even more exaggerated. So why this weird also zigzagging can be amplified is when we have features on different scales. So for instance, imagine a data set where we have, let's say, I don't know, the age of a person from 10 to 50 years, and then let's say the income of a person, let's say from, I don't know, 10,000 to, let's say, $500,000 or something like that. So these are on vastly different scales, right? And remember how we do gradient descent. So usually what we do is we have the weight update, let's say weight 1, we would update it by weight 1 minus the partial derivative of the loss with respect to that weight, and then times a learning rate alpha, right? So in this part, this computation involves usually x, the input itself. For example, it could be y hat minus y times, let's say, x1 is the input feature. So here, the input feature kind of scales the whole thing. And then if we have input features on very different scales, then, well, finding a good learning rate would be hard. We would have to choose a learning rate for each weight individually, and that would be a lot of hassle. So for instance, because if we consider now W2 minus alpha like this. So let's say this one and this one, these learning rates, we usually use the same learning rate. And this really only works well if the features are on the same scale, right? Because if this one is like 1,000 times larger, we may have to use a 1,000 times smaller learning rate to get a good behavior. Another thing is also that most optimization algorithms really work well if the features are centered at zero and have only like a small, small values around zero. One issue is also always when we have very large or very small numbers in a computational context, because then we also have computational instability issues. So one common theme that works pretty well in practice is z-score standardization. So people just call it standardization. It's essentially giving your data or features the properties of a standard normal distribution. I mean, the data after applying this won't be normal if it wasn't normal before, but it has the properties of a standard normal distribution, which is zero mean and unit variance. So unit variance is a fancy word for saying that the standard deviation is 1 or the variance is 1. So again, if the data is not normal to begin with, this won't change. This won't really change the distribution how it looks like. It's just people say it has the parameters of a normal distribution because essentially it will have zero mean and unit variance. But just think of it as here as centering the data with standard deviation or variance 1. So how it works is for each feature. So let's say this is for a particular data point. So we want to scale data point I. Let's say this is like an iris flower I, and we want to scale the jth feature, where j might be something like, let's say, sepal length. And how we do that is we subtract the feature mean. So here the feature mean, this would be over all flowers, so 1 over n, right? Ah, let me do this properly here. 1 over n, I equals 1, n, and then x, I, j. So we will just compute the mean across this feature. And here we do the same thing for the standard deviation. And this is essentially it. This usually helps with a better behavior. So we will then usually have a more symmetric loss surface. But again, this only applies really if we have a very simple generalized linear model, like linear regression in this case, for example. If we have something else like a deep neural network, this won't be a convex loss function anymore. But still, it helps to standardize the inputs. It's still recommended in practice. Okay, so this is one way we can standardize the inputs. But now when we talk about deep neural networks, so let's say we have the inputs here, x1 and x2, and then we have activations a1, a2, a3, and then let's say we have two output units, let's call it o1 and o2. Okay, so previously, on the previous slide, we talked about standardizing these things here, right? So the inputs. Now, what about the activations? Might also be helpful to standardize the activations that go then into these output layer, right? So that might also be helpful to standardize the activations, the hidden layer activations, because you can really think of these A's here as the activations. You can think of them as the inputs to the next layer. They're essentially just like X, except that these are the inputs to the next layer. So in the next video, I want to talk about one technique called batch norm, which is essentially a variant of this standardization for standardizing hidden activations. It's coming with a twist. There will be a learnable or two learnable parameters for that, but essentially you can think of it as standardization of the hidden layer activations. So that will be the topic of the next video.